God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day, to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Dun, dun, dun. Merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day, to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. That's medley there was from a group called the Pentatonics. The Pentatonics. Okay. And it's of course had a number of songs there, carol songs, and started and ended with God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen, a Christmas carol, very popular. So I'm Reverend Cyril. I welcome you this evening to the Sentinel, which is the media arm of Citygate Ministries International. And yes, I say I welcome you this evening, but of course it could be at another time where you are, where you're based. It could be morning time, it could be afternoon, it could be night time, it could be whatever it is anyway. God bless you, and I wish you a Merry Christmas. Happy celebration of the Incarnation. Let's not forget, that's what's about. So this is a Christmas kind of message or reflection this evening. Now, of course, usually the Sentinel happens on Sunday evenings, but I decided to shift it to today, being Christmas. Let us use the opportunity and that the season presents to just wish every one of you and yours and your families Merry Christmas, and in anticipation of the new year, again, I wish you great new year. What's happening here? Why? Okay. I think that was a pause there. I don't know why, but anyway. God bless you. Okay. Let me start by looking at today's title. This evening's title, I called it Appreciating the Christ in Christmas. Now, just look at the spelling of Christmas. If you like, write it down, scribble it somewhere, spell it fully. Do not abbreviate it. Don't shorten it. You know, do not write Xmas. Appreciate the stem of that word. That is Christ. Okay, Christ is the stem of the word. And if you like, Christmas is might be considered as the suffix. So it's Christmas. And if you want to be really, really deliberate about it, you can say Christmas. Now, what does that mean? The worship, you know, mass, worship service unto Christ. Yes? Okay. So what's about? Of course, we know throughout the Christian world, we know that it is the time that we celebrate and commemorate the incarnation. It's time we commemorate the birth of Christ. And I say incarnation because in Christian theology, and of course, according to biblical revelation, God became flesh and dwelt among us and tabernacled with us and identified with us and breathed our air. The air we breathe, that's what I mean. Ate our food, the food we eat, bought and sold in our market. You know, he was a carpenter, he offered his services, and so on and so forth. So he participated in our humanity. God came down to us. That is the incarnation. That is a mystery. That is a wonder. That is a miracle. That is good news. That God identified with us through the coming of his son Jesus Christ. So let me read a couple of scriptures here to start with, to focus us. Remember, the title is Appreciating the Christ of Christmas. We need to. Anybody that celebrates Christmas, yeah, please bear in mind, it's not just the turkey, which I ate, of course, the whatever the food, again, as much as I could. It's not just the gifts, and I got some, you know, some good gifts from precious people, loved ones. Yes. Much as we celebrate and we rejoice at those things, and please, the exhortation this evening is that we should really, really reflect on what this occasion is about. Christmas. Appreciating the Christ in Christmas. That is the center. That's what this, you know, they say, that's a saying, a popular saying, that Christ is the reason for the season. So apt, so apt. Now, if we forget that, everything we do is a futility. Okay, well, you know, anything we do about Christmas is just a waste of time. You know, some people will get caught up in the commercialism, the economic frenzy, and buying and selling, and of course, government is interested to know the volume of business that happened, you know, in this season. They want to quantify it in pounds and sterling, pound sterling and pence and dollars and cents and naira and kobo and cedis and pesewas and so on and so forth. So they would like to kind of quantify it and say, yes, they know, how was it this season? They're interested in looking at the books and the economic performance and yeah. Okay, but yes, okay, all that, I'm not fine, all that happens. But it will all be futile, fruitless, meaningless if we neglect the Christ of Christmas. Think about it. Can you imagine having a birthday for a friend, a loved one, and everybody comes and they eat and drink and dance and they exchange gifts, but nobody remembers the celebrant? Wouldn't that be weird? It would be strange. You know, like nobody remembers this celebrant. In fact, people don't even believe that he exists. People are totally oblivious of him or her. So let us not do that. That's daft. That would be silly. Okay. Let's go and as we explore what this is about. This will not be long. I don't plan it to be long. But anyway, Isaiah chapter 9, start from verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice, from that time forward, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform it, will perform this. Okay, I stop there. Note that the verse 6 says, for unto us a child is born, yes, and that's we're celebrating that child that was born over 2,000 years ago today. Now, disclaimer, I'm not saying that Christ was born on the 25th of December. No, he wasn't. Most likely, he wasn't. Some people tell you that, okay, this has a pagan background and whatever. Yes, there is some kind of non-Christian historicity to it. But then, we are not going to run away from this world because, or maybe around this time, because, you know, some kind of this day or whatever day was dedicated, time passed by some people to the veneration of their idols and whatever. However, while we are in this world, we're not of the world, and the Christian community or the Christian world has the right, God-given right, to pronounce any day, any year, any season, the day, the year, the season the Lord has made, and we will be glad and rejoice in it. So we can choose that time. In fact, we can remember the birth of Christ, the incarnation, at any time of the year, and on any day. In fact, every day, every hour. We should remember, in that sense, Christmas can be every day. So this 25th of December has been designated as a time that we reflect and remember, not to say that this is Christ's birthday as such, but that, yes, Christ, God's Son, God's eternal Son, was given to us. He came to us in form of a baby, grew up among us, then of course he died for us later, he was crucified, and he rose from the dead, ascended to heaven, and coming back. So that's the summary of the life of Christ on earth. So we focus on his birth and reflecting on what that means to us and for us. So unto us a child is born, praise God. This child was born for us. So we have a stake in the fact that this child was born. It is unto us that the child was born. We're not just born to the mother, the parents and the ethnic siblings and his community. It was unto us. Now you have to put yourself among the us, wherever you are, whether you are Jew, Gentile, American, African, Asian, North American, South American, Central American, wherever you are from, Saudi Arabia, whether you're a Muslim, a Hindu, a Buddhist, whatever you are, you can be a man or woman, boy or girl, old or young, you can put yourself and your name in that. Unto me, Cyril, a child is born. You have to personally appropriate this gift. Okay, so the second one that tells us, unto us a son is given. Yes. He said, no, unto us, this child, oh, he's a son, is given to us. He's given to us. It's a gift. Hallelujah. This is a gift to us. Oh, why? I said that the government will be upon his shoulder. Now, of course, I don't talk about his name being called Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Now, he says government will be upon his shoulder. So this child is born to rule. I'm not going to go there tonight. But just remember that this child has given unto us. This child that was born to us, the son given to us, was born to rule. To rule over us. So we welcome our king. You know, I live in the UK. When a future heir to the throne is born, the nation like lighten up. You know, that's excitement in the air, that an heir to the throne has been born. Now this heir might be, he survived, you know, he lives long enough. Yeah. When he's due to ascend the throne. Yeah, of course he will. And it might be up, maybe, I don't know, 30 years down the line, 40, 50, 60, 70 even. Like Prince Charles ascended the throne in his 70s. Okay? But from the time he was born as a baby, the nation was, celebrated that, yes, an heir to the throne had been born. Okay? Until the due time, the fullness of time when he ascended the throne. So also, this child, Jesus, was born as a baby, but remember, he was born to rule. He was born to be king. So, as we, part of appreciating this gift we are given is to appreciate the role he comes to play in our lives. He's coming to order our lives, to govern our lives, our communities, our nations. And so we should prepare for him and open our spaces for him, our lives, our families, our hearts for him, because he's no longer a baby now, of course. He's come and done what he meant to do. Now he's exhausted as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The response now for us to open our hearts. So part of appreciating him, as the title suggests, is for us to open our hearts to receive this gift. And receiving him means that we give him opportunity to govern us, to rule over us. That is the mandate. The government will be upon his shoulder. Let me see. But yes, we are emphasizing the fact that it's a gift unto us. That's the most popular, I would say, I think, verse in the Bible. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but will have eternal life, everlasting life. He gave us the same son, Jesus. God so loved. So this gift is a gift of love. It's a love gift. God loves us so much. God loves you so much. God loves your family so much that he gave his son, Jesus Christ, his only son, that whoever, does not matter how you are treated in the world, does not matter whether you're a man or woman, it does not matter what you've done, what you've not done, it does not matter where your cultural background, your pedigree, your social status, it does not matter whether you're educated or not, it doesn't matter whether you're sophisticated or just simple. Whoever believes in him, do you believe in him? Have you received him? If you do, say you will not perish, but you have eternal life. If you don't, that's probably in my head. Prediction is ahead. It's a gift. Yeah? Let's amplify that. If you receive him and believe in him, you have a everlasting life, eternal life. If you don't, the answer hangs in the air. It's a gift, yeah? 1 John chapter 5, verse 11. Let me read from New King James Version. And this is the testimony. King James Version says, and this is the record. New American Standard Version says, and the witness is this. It's like a declaration. Okay, what is the witness then? This is the testimony that God, that God, the Creator, has given us, again, us. He gave it to you, has given me eternal life. And this life that he's giving can only be found in his son. Sorry if you believe that there are different options. My friends, there are no options. There are no alternative routes to salvation, to eternal life, to eternal rest. There is no other way except through Jesus Christ. He said, this is the testimony that God has given you, me, eternal life. And this life, this very life, is in his son. So that's why he gave us his son. That's why unto us his son is given. You get it? Get it? Okay. So it's a gift. A gift is initiated by the giver. In this case, it's God. Why did he give us the gift? Because he loved us. John 3:16 tells us that. He loved us. And God, who loves us, who knows all things, who's all powerful, could have done different things to relieve us of our dilemma. Because God knows us. He knows that we lost it when through the fall of Adam and Eve. We lost it. We lost the paradise. So we became victims and casualties of death, of happenstances and circumstances, of sickness and disease and penury and lack of famine and disasters and just all manner of things. We're subjected to suffering and sorrow, tears and gall. But The Bible says God is love. He still loves us. So he had to respond. You know, how if you're, I mean, as a good father or mother, if your child is in trouble, you would do everything. You move heaven and earth to deliver them from their whatever situation that threatens them. God is better. God is more loving than us. So he was moved, and so he had to respond in his almightiness, in his omniscience, in all wisdom, in his omnipresence, in his omniscience, his unknowingness. And so what would he do? What step would he take? Of course, he's done things before. He delivered people, he rescued people, he even healed people, you know. Different things we see God did, you know, in the Old Testament, God did through Christ Jesus. But he thought about what to do, what something to do that will break the backbone of our, you know, the enslavement once and for all. He said to make one move, one strategic move. Never mind all the things he'd done before, which are fantastic and amazing and miraculous. But one strategic move that the Almighty, all-knowing, all-seeing, omnipresent God will do, that he knows in his wisdom that this will be an answer, a silver bullet to deal with man's dilemma and deliver us from death and the power of darkness and the powers that harass us. His trump card, what the Jesuits would call Joker, his Joker, yes? The thing that his strong card that is hidden, he hid in his chest. You know, you don't like people to see your trump card if you're playing card. And the Bible says that there are things that are hidden from the people of old, hidden from the wise and the prudent, hidden from the prophets of even, I mean, the people of old, even believers of old, hidden from generations past. At the fullness of time, God released it. And that was Zechariah celebrated. You know, if you read the Luke chapter 1, Mary is celebrated. You know? Praise God. So, God sending Christ to us, to die for us, is God's master stroke, most strategic stroke, trump card, that the devil has no answer to, the world has no answer to, the powers of darkness have no answer to, hell has no answer to, death has no answer to, sin has no answer to. So it's a precious gift. I hope you see, appreciate him as a precious gift from God. His name shall be called Jesus, we are told in Matthew. For he shall save his people from their sins. That's why he's given, to save you from your sins, to save him from my sins. And Matthew said, tells us that, yes, this is a fulfillment of what was written in this time, Isaiah chapter 7, I will read it, you know, that his name shall be called Emmanuel, which means God is with us. God came down to us, incarnation. So then, appreciating the Christ in Christmas, we appreciate him as a gift from God, and for what he came to do, which I mentioned, to save us from our sins, to reconcile us to God, to unite us with God, to save us from the powers of darkness, To save us from the penalties of sin, to deliver us from the curse of the law. But you see, as in any gift, there are different attitudes, you know, to gifts. When people are offered gifts. One, people might be totally ignorant of what they have been given. So they don't even know that the gift is for them. Maybe through literacy or cultural ignorance or for whatever reason, they don't know. Or nobody has ever given a gift before, so they say, whoa, is it? No, it cannot be for me. No. But God has given us a gift. So for that, they don't even consider that it's for them. But the Bible tells us that it's for you, it's for me and you. We need it. So they will not appreciate it. Secondly, some people are given a gift and they turn their nose at the gift. No. They look at it with disdain. They're like, you hold me. What is this nonsense? What is this? What is this? You know, what is this? And I've seen people, you know, people in close quarters and, you know, or at close quarters and also maybe, yeah, watching on people on TV or YouTube or whatever. They are given the gifts and they look at it and say, what nonsense is this? They are not thinking of the heart of the person who gave them the gift. They look at it, they feel it's too small, it's too cheap, it's beneath them. So they treat it with disdain. I hope you are not guilty of treating the gift of God this Christmas with disdain. Look at it and say, what matters to you is the turkey, what matters to you is the Christmas goat, what matters to you is the food and the drinks and the parties and the nice clothes, and what matters to you is the gift you receive. But the gift of God you despise. May you not be guilty of that in Jesus' name. Some people too might get the gift and take it, say thank you, you know, get excited about it, but then they don't open it. Yeah, it's like sometimes, you know, wedding gifts, you know, some people, I remember some gifts were given, yes, it took years to even open some of them, just left them, you know. It took years for us to open some of them. There are many. Okay, some people, they get, you know, a gift like that, like the gift that God is giving, and they just put it in the storage. They don't even bother to open it. Not talk of use it. Some people even open it, and that's it. They get excited, and they use it, you know, maybe, you know, for a short time, and then discard it, like children, the way children treat toys. They get toys, they're excited about it, and then they look at it and then they don't use it again. Or some of us adults, we get some of these exercise gadgets, equipment, and we get them and we use them for a while and then we abandon them. We will not be guilty of using, you know, God's gift that way. You know, I remember I had this phone. Is it black? It's called BlackBerry, I think, you know this. My daughter used to, many years ago, my daughter used to laugh at me. She used to say that the only thing you know how to do with this phone, you know, I said this phone could do much, but the only thing you know what to do with it is to make a call and send it text messages. So you're underusing the, you know, this gadget. You're underusing it. May we not take the grace of God in vain. Okay. So in that case, they can see, oh, Christmas, Christ has Christmas, fantastic. Oh, Jesus, I love you. Fantastic. Thank you. But then they leave him. They don't unpack the gift. You know, find out, you know, different things that how this gift can be serviceable to them. How they can benefit from this gift. Because if it came from God, then there are depths and layers to it that needs to be unveiled and unraveled and taken advantage of. And the last attitude is hopefully we should aspire to be in this category. Those, they receive the gift, they appreciate the gift, they're deeply appreciative, they know the God that, they know, they see in the gift, the love, the magnanimity, and the kindness of the giver. They see God through his gifts. And knowing that God is all-knowing, all-powerful, God knows our needs more than we ever know, then they marvel at this gift. They contemplate on this gift. They look at this gift. They read about it. They read the manual. They read the Bible. They just examine this gift. Explore the gift. How can I put this gift into use? How can I, you know, maximize and optimize this gift and what it can do? What else can it, you know, can it deliver to me? How else are you to explore? And when you do that with Jesus Christ, God's gift to you, you find out that there are layers. The Bible talks about in Ephesians chapter 3, Paul talked about describing it as unsearchable riches of Christ, the unsearchable, the depth, you know, the depth of the glorious riches that's in Christ Jesus for us. For us. We pray that God might open our eyes to know the riches of a glory, that we have in Christ Jesus. The Bible says that the person, he who did not spare his only son, but deliver him, who did not spare his only son, but deliver him to us all, how wouldn't he, through him, give us all things? That God did not spare his only son, his own son, Jesus, but gave him up. It's a gift. It's a gift to us, all of us. It's us all. That means you're included. See, how will he not, how will this God not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? So Christ becomes the answer to every question we may have. He becomes the answer to every angst, every, issue that bothers us. All the contradictions of life we face, Christ is the answer. So let us be like the last category and accept him with gladness, and then explore as we worship him, as we appreciate him, as we value him, as we pray to him, as we just bless his name, as we celebrate him, as we learn about him, as we study him, as we examine him, as we explore him, as we gaze into his face. The Bible says that we see the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. What a dazzling gift. What an enriching gift. What a life-impacting gift. Thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift. Amen and amen. Merry Christmas to you. Merry Christmas to you and yours. Merry Christmas. May the blessings of Christmas, the blessings of Christmas, the blessings of Emmanuel be on you, upon you, upon your family, upon me and my family, upon our loved ones, upon everything that concerns us, as we celebrate and appreciate the Christ in Christmas. God bless you. Bye-bye. And remember, Reverend Cyril Okere. And see you next, as we celebrate the new year. See you next Sunday. Yeah, next Sunday. This has been the Sentinel. And yes, if you want to find out more things about us, please feel free to check our YouTube channel, Citygate TV, to learn more. And if you want to know more about us again, you can visit our website, citygateministries.org.uk, and you can leave us whatever message you want to pass on to us. We appreciate it, and you can do that at info@citygateministries.org.uk. With that, I say God bless you and have a Merry Christmas, and God bless you as we prepare for the new year. God bless. Bye.